So hi there, and welcome to another episode of Fat... You know what?
People, we've uploaded enough of these
people,
now.
Like, we've uploaded enough, you get it by now. We're here to talk about some bullshit. Let's go. So Brad, today's topic is musical moments that get you mad fucking hype. So if the audience at home, would you like to discuss the criteria for this one while I just like pour myself a bit more rum into this bastard?
Yes, I believe the criteria is that we're looking for moments in movies or in television.
Or video games.
Or video games.
Or indeed any piece of media that can involve music.
Where the music comes in at the just the right moment, it's just the right music. It gets you mad hype for what you're watching or playing.
Or like happen to be doing at that moment in time. So, immediately I want to discount virtually every Disney movie. Because we had this discussion before, didn't we? If we just said like, what's the hypest music or best music in a piece of media? We'd just say, okay, well, Disney movies. And I think, though, they shouldn't count because my criteria for these moments is, like, without the music, the scene or moment in question still works. It's just that the music perfectly complements it. So let's say, for example, we use the movie Frozen and Let It Go, like an immensely popular song that a lot of people agree fits that scene. If you take that song out, what is that scene? That scene is, like, you know, a collection of shots of a woman walking around the wilderness, randomly firing bolts of ice out of her hands. And the same can be said for virtually every other Disney movie with a song in it, where if you take that song out, the scene it's in makes no sense. And before we continue to the new editor we've got in for these videos, I know that this one's going to get, like, you know, copyright strikes out the fucking arsehole, so I don't care. I'll take the hit on this one, because I just want to get hype and talk about some cool shit. Put in as long a clip as you need to demonstrate what we're talking about. And you know what? Don't even bother putting in that royalty-free music in the background, because fuck it, this one's going to get flagged by somebody. You may as well put in the songs we're talking about. And we're going to start with what I think is, like, you know, it's diametrically opposed to Disney movies, and that is DreamWorks movies.
Right.
And we're going to start with How to Train Your Dragon. The first flight with Hiccup and Toothless. Because, like, I think it's John Powell did the soundtrack for that movie. That first flight, I think the music swells at the exact right fucking moment where you just get that little feeling in your chest going, oh, that's so good.
It does it multiple times
yes,
in one scene.
Throughout that scene. The scene's like 2 minutes long. But there are multiple moments throughout that where the music swells exactly the right moment. If you listen carefully enough, it's almost like you can hear it, almost like the editor that we've got like editing this video is playing it in the background right now because we don't give a fuck about copyright strikes. And it's swelling right now. It's like, and my favourite part I've seen being where Hiccup has got the, like, the sign in front of him, how to fly the dragon, how to train your dragon, and he throws it away because he's like, you know what? I ain't got time. I've got to fly on instinct. And he kicks in, he kicks his foot back, and he perfectly knows the exact thing to do at that moment. Because at that moment, boy and dragon become one. And they fly, and the music swells, and he does all the sick loop-the-loops through the... Oh, it's the best. They do it again in the second movie, and they use that, like, they use that original piece of music by John Powell as the leitmotif of the song Where No One Goes. And what during, again, a flight with Hiccup and Toothless, as, like, you know, boy and dragon are now more in sync than ever, and they do the same thing again. And it's a cheap-ass trick, I know, but they have the music swell just as they go above the clouds, and he does the thing where he puts his arms out and they fly in unison. It's like, oh, it's so good. And I think as well, because there's a great example of how we can do this and not have it work, because you pointed this out to me when I mentioned that this is what I wanted to talk about for the first example. The whole, like, oh, first flight thing is a trope in cinema. And it's used in the film Big Hero 6. And we watched that scene immediately after watching the How to Train Your Dragon one, and after both me and Brad were like, yeah, you go, Hiccup and Toothless, you fly that motherfucking dragon, you go. You do those loop-the-loops. And the Big Hero 6 one does exactly the same thing. And like, you know, I read it's going to put behind us now, put an example, like both scenes, and show that they do the exact same thing. They have the bit where, like, you know, they fall slowly, and then just before they hit the water, fly off at 100 miles an hour. But if you watch the Big Hero 6 version of that scene, it just falls completely flat, because the music choice is just so safe and generic, and it doesn't really, like, you know, complement the action whatsoever. And I think that's a shame, but it shows that, like, you know, that John Powell soundtrack in How It Generated is fucking phenomenal. Because, like, every time I watch it, and I've watched that film like a dozen or so times, I fucking love How It Train Your Dragon. It still gets me every time. And to go back to the criteria that I, like, mentioned at the start of this piece, that scene on its own is awesome, but the music just elevates it to being like, this is now art. This went from being like a high pass piece of action in a great film to being like, this is my favourite moment from a piece of media released in the last decade. So in that vein, Brad, do you have another example?
So because we've discounted like most Disney.
Yes.
Because they're all musicals for the most part.
Pretty much, yeah.
I'm actually going to throw a Disney one in, but it's okay. Not from a musical. It's from the first Pirates of the Caribbean film.
I think I know which bit you're going to be talking about.
It's the first introduction of Captain Jack Sparrow.
Yeah.
Because the music in the background of that just... it perfectly fits the introduction of the character.
Yeah.
And it's the first time you hear his theme, I think.
Yeah. And it fades out and it comes back in at the right moment. And then you have that, like, the iconic shot of him riding the top of the boat, and he steps off just onto the pier as his boat sinks down. And that is a great moment, but I'm going to counter the gauntlet you've thrown with the word Disney on it with a bigger gauntlet with the word Shrek 2 written on it.
Oh, Christ. You're bringing it back to DreamWorks.
No, you know what? I am going to play the Shrek 2 card. And there's a lot of music used in the Shrek series. And I think, like, a lot of the songs do fit. But I'm going to go for, at the end of Shrek 2, like, you know, I Need a Hero. And I know it's a cheap trope to have a song that's describing the action that's going on screen in the background. And in most Disney movies, they always have a singer sing the song and then an actor or an actress do the voice of the character. Whereas in this one, they actually recorded a cover of I Need a Hero and got Jennifer Saunders to sing it. And by all accounts, she did a fucking phenomenal job. And I'd also like go back to my criteria and say, if you cut out the song, like, from that scene and just have the bit of, like, you know, Shrek rushing the castle, it works as an action scene. If you just had, like, you know, generic, I don't know, like, Big Hero 6 orchestral music in the background, it'd work. But just the inclusion of I Need a Hero sung by a character in the fucking movie. And as well, they even go to the effort of establishing that it makes sense in the context of the scene, because she's singing it on stage. And as well, the action occurs in real time as the song is being sung, which a lot of movies, like, you know, that overuse this trope, like, it's a rule they don't really follow.
All right, big fella, let's crash this party.
And I've always appreciated how the music fades out at the moment Puss in Boots jumps off the back of Donkey, and it, like, goes out to, like, this wonderful, like, you know, little piano-y bit. And he turns around and goes to Shrek and goes, I will repay my debt. And he looks, and he looks at all the guards in the eye. He has the Puss in Boots big eye face. And the music swells back up. And he's just like, you know what? I'm just going to do some sick ass pussy combos on your bum holes. Brad, do you have another example to counter Shrek 2? Can you counter the girth of Shrek?
Well, I remember when we were discussing this, we mentioned a few times about music and games that changes between...
Contextual music.
Contextual music, that's it. Because the new Devil May Cry is going to have it.
Yes.
And obviously you go mad hype about Revengeance, which
you can't take Revengeance from me, Brad.
I'm giving it to you.
I'm
passing it over.
Okay, well, thank you for passing. Like, basically, you've just done. What we've done there is we're on the same side now. And you're passing me shit to spike into the pavement. And, oh, God, Revengeance is music for people who don't know. Like, you, like, every time you enter a boss battle... it will play, like, the boss's theme song. And the boss is always, like, it's a piece of, like, you know, instrumental music up until like predetermined hype moments where you get to, like, you have like marginal control over them, but they occur when you do a set amount of damage to the enemy. And then you'll go into like slow motion and like kick them off a building or like cut a piece of their armor off. But at that exact moment, that's when the lyrics come in. And because like the game is specifically programmed to only play lyrics when those moments happen, it always feels like the music is perfectly synced to your playing.
When you go into like the what's the precision mode called?
Zandatsu.
Yeah, when you go into that and start cutting and the lyrics just kick in, yeah, ready for you to slice.
And the power vocals always come in at the exact moment something hype happens. So it always feels like the song is perfectly in sync with the action on screen. So which means that it perfectly fits with your play style. And the best example, like, there's so many good songs in that game, but the one that always gets me is when you fight Monsoon. Because not only does he give a big ass speech about memes, where he literally uses the line, "Your memes end here," which is fucking brilliant, it's the most butt rock soundtrack ever, and you enter Ripper mode, which is like Raiden's devil trigger, where he just glows with red sex power. And it ends with you running up this giant stone pillar that he fires at you using magnet power, that you run up as a guitar solo plays, that you jump off, cut through a tank, and then drop kick into a wall, and then just go absolutely ape shit with your sword.
I'm going to regret this as well.
Okay.
But seeing as we're talking about video games, Transformers Devastation.
That's another one. We've got to do it. Brad, what's the line? It starts with "Prepare to be lost in space, Autobots." And there's a like, Transformers Devastation. It doesn't have contextual music a la Revengeance or Devil May Cry 5, but it does just have a really good butt rock soundtrack.
Prepare to be lost in space, Autobots.
Let's introduce people to something they may not have seen. Do you have anything that's like less well-known?
Well, one that I've always wanted to mention in a video we've done before, we've never had like an opportunity, is Run Lola Run, which is an amazing like German movie, I believe. Three short films, like 20 minutes long, that like, make 1 hour long movie. As the title suggests, it's about a woman called Lola who's got to run her fucking ass off. And the song that accompanies the first run in the film just fits it so well. And I'm assuming as I'm talking, there is a clip of like Lola hauling an immense amount of ass, playing either over my voice
or other shoulder,
or over one of my shoulders. And the song that plays in the background, I think it's really understated. Like, compared to some of the other songs we talked about, it's not as bombastic or as in your face, but it's just this really subtle, understated, like, German trance track that reminiscent of a ticking clock. It doesn't ever like reach a crescendo, it's just constantly in the background, like a ticking clock, because obviously that's the plot of the movie. It's like she's got 20 minutes to save her boyfriend, spoilers, yeah. And she's just hauling ass as it plays. And it's just one of those ones, it's like, this really fits the action on screen. Like, there's so many. And the thing is though, there are other ones we haven't yet mentioned, but for runtime, we have to cut this one short. So, if you have any examples of like, you know, songs that perfectly complement and then hype up the action that's currently happening on screen, let us know in the comments, unless I've disabled them, if that's still a thing we're doing. But, oh man, that fucking Run Lola Run. I need to go watch that film again. It's fucking fantastic.